Good morning, all of you. We will continue. Yes, good morning. We will continue with the civics chapter, power sharing. And yesterday we began this chapter and we have done the two stories, one from Belgium and one from Sri Lanka. And we have seen that at both the places there were ethnic differences and there was diversity on the basis of language and religion. And we also saw that how the two countries, they dealt with this problem. And so, you know, the Belgium, we have seen that the leaders, they realize that it is only when we respect the feelings and the interests of all the communities and regions and religions, then only we can have the unity of the country. And so, you know, this resulted that they made mutually acceptable arrangements for power sharing. And we have seen that in Belgium, when we have looked at the Belgian model, we have seen that in central government also, the number of Dutch and French speaking community people, the minister shall be equal in the central government. So though the Dutch were in majority in the country, still they accepted that okay, there would be equal number of for Dutch speaking and French speaking members in the central government. And so when it came to Brussels having its own government, there the French speaking also, though they were 80% there, still they also were ready, they accepted equal representation in Brussels, because the Dutch speaking community, they have accepted equal representation in the central government. So they realized in Belgium that if you have to live together, if you have to look after the unity of the country, then every person who is living in the country, their needs and their interests and their welfare needs to be safeguarded. And so they made arrangements likewise. But in Sri Lanka, we saw a very contrasting and opposite example. And we saw that Sinhalas were 74% there. And so, you know, after coming to power, they thought that we will exert our dominance over the country. And we see that when they tried to do that, when they exerted their dominance over others and they refused to give any power, any share to the other community, to the Tamilians, then we saw that how there were so many conflicts and it led to even civil war in the country. And so we see that if we do not want to share power, all right, and we want to, and if the majority community, they want to exert their dominance on the minority community, then it can even lead to the disunity or the disintegration of the country. So we have seen till there, and now today we will have a look at why sharing of power, or why this power sharing is so desirable, why everyone likes this power sharing. So two different sets of reasons can be given in favor of power sharing, and the first is prudential reason and the second are the moral reasons. Now prudential reasons, basically they stress that the power sharing will have better outcomes. So power sharing is desirable because it leads to better end results, and so we favor and so we desire power sharing. Whereas the moral reasons, they simply emphasize that you know, power sharing in itself is valuable, and so we need to do that just because it is good. So it is just because of moral reasons, because something is good, because something is valuable and profitable, so we need to do that. Those are the moral reasons. But prudential reasons, they lead to better outcomes. So we'll have a look at both the reasons that why power sharing is so desirable. First, now why power sharing is good? Because it reduces the possibility of a conflict between different social groups. Now we have already seen in case of Belgium and also Sri Lanka, you know, that there were conflicts between the people. But the Belgians, they decided that no, we will share power. And so, you know, because they decided to share power with all the communities there, so, you know, they reduced the conflict there. Whereas in Sri Lanka, the conflict between the two communities, there was so much distress that it intensified to that limit that it led to civil war in the country. And so first, what is the prudential reason? That it reduces the possibility of conflict among the different social groups. Then Second, power sharing is a good way to ensure the stability of the political order. So it leads to the stability of political order. Now, what that basically means is that now social conflict, if there is a conflict in the country or among the different social groups, so if there is a conflict among the different social groups, then you know what will happen. The people would be fighting in the country, and you know that the government would have to look after means and ways to take care of that. And so, you know, basically what happens is that it could lead to the disunity of the country. And so the political nature would also be, you know, unstable. It would be unstable because the people would not be happy with the ruling government. So what would they want? They would want to remove the government and bring a new government that would be, you know, concerned about or sensitive to their needs and demands. And so they would want to change this government. So the government won't be stable. So social conflicts, it can lead to violence and instability in politics. And so power sharing is a good way. If we share power, then it will lead to the stability of political order. All people would be happy with the government and the government would be stable. Then, you know, if the majority community, they want to impose and force their will on the minority community, so, you know, in the short run, it would appear very attractive that, okay, now we will have all the power, and because we are more in number, so we will make the minority community do as per our wishes. But you know, in the long run, the unity of the country would be at stake, because those people, the minority communities, who for long would be not treated equally, would be suppressed. So obviously, you know, a time would come that would start asking for a separate country or a separate nation, like we saw in the case of Sri Lanka also, that they started demanding for a separate Tamil Ilam or a separate Tamil state where they can work for their own welfare. So it can lead to that also. Now, the last point under prudential reason is that tyranny of the majority, it's not just oppressive for the minority, it often brings ruin to the minority. So if the majority, those who are in majority, if they are cruel, all right, if they are tyrants, if they are cruel, then not only will they be oppressive, obviously they will suppress the minority community, and they will, you know, try to impose rules on them to bring them under control, to dominate over them. But in the end, it will also lead to the ruin of the majority community as well. So because of these reasons, you know, power sharing is desirable. Now, these are the prudential reasons. Why? Because power sharing, if we share power, so it will lead to better outcomes. So we should go for power sharing. These were the prudential reasons. Now, moral reasons. Now, the second moral, deeper reason is that why power sharing is good for democracies. Now, we say that power sharing is the very spirit of democracy. Why? Because, you know, democracy is what? It is... Yes, what is democracy? Come on, what is democracy?
Ma'am, government of the people, by the people and for the
people. Alright, so it is rule of the people. Alright, so it is rule of the people. If it is our rule, alright, and if I am to be affected by whatever rules and regulations are made, laws are made, and I have to live with the effects of the rules and regulations, then I also need to have a right to be consulted as to what to do and what not to do. All right, because if, like, I am a citizen of this country, and you know, so whatever rules and regulations and laws are made, then obviously I would be affected by it, and then I have to live with the effects of that. So it will be better that I also should be consulted as to how I want to be governed, how I myself want to be governed. And so this is the moral reason for democracy, for power sharing, that you know, what would be a legitimate government? A government where all the citizens, where, you know, obviously all not possible, but as many citizens, you know, through participation, they can have a share in the system. Now, a legitimate government is what government? Where citizens, through their participation, now their participation can be in any form. Now, through their participation, they also have a share in the governance or in the system. So these are the moral reasons why, because it is the spirit of democracy, and those people who are to be affected by the laws, all right, and those who have to live with effect, with its effects, so they need to be consulted as to how they want to be governed. So these are the moral and the prudential reasons that why power sharing is so desirable. Okay, you can read this Khalil's dilemma at home, and we will deal with it later on. So it is just a story. You go through it. You cannot leave anything, whatever is given in the chapter. So whether it is in a box or whether it is in a source or meanings, everything you have to do. So just go through it and we will talk about it later on. Let's move on to the various forms of power sharing. Now earlier, you know, it was thought that power should be undivided. Means one person should have all power, all right, and so all power of a government, it should reside with one person or a group of people, all right, and this group of people should be located living at one place. Now why it was said? Because, you know, they thought that if power was dispersed among different people, then, you know, it will not be able to take quick decisions, all right, and to enforce them, because then so many people need to be consulted. Then you have to consult, if so many people are involved in a decision making process, then obviously you need to consult and discuss and deliberate with all of them, and so obviously it will take time. Sometimes people will agree, sometimes they will not agree, they will have their own views, all right, and so it will take time to take quick decisions and to enforce them. That is why earlier it was thought that it is better that all governing power should be in one hand or in a group of people. But you know, these thoughts, these notions, now they have changed with the emergence of a new type of governance, that is democracy. And now, you know, in democracy, the basic principle is that people, they are the source of all power, because, you know, it is government which is formed by them, all right? They are the government. The people are the government. So they are the source of all power, all right? And now in a democracy, we rule ourselves through institutions or self-governance. Means we make institutions so that we can be self-governed. So basically, it is the people who are ruling themselves through their representatives. And so, in a good democracy, you know, due respect, proper respect should be given to all the groups, different diverse groups, religions, communities which are living, and due respect should be given to all the views and all the people who are living in that particular country. So in a democracy, proper respect should be given to all diverse groups and all views that exist there. And you know, everyone, you know, we all have our own way of thinking and looking at things. So we all have our own views and opinions, and everyone, you know, has a voice. And so that voice should be heard when making policies for the people. Like if I am to be governed, if I am to be affected by the rules and laws, then obviously I should also have a say in how I want to be governed. And therefore, you know, in a democracy, political power should be divided among as many citizens as possible. So in a democracy, we try to distribute this power among as many people as possible. And so in modern democracies, this sharing of power, now it can take various forms. It can be in various forms. So here, let us look at some of the most common forms of power sharing that we come across in democracies. Now, first is the sharing of power among the different organs of the government. Now, this you have already studied, you know. All right, so what are the various organs of government? How many organs of the government do we have?
Ma'am, three.
All right, name them.
Ma'am, legislature, executive and judiciary.
And judiciary. What does the legislature do?
Ma'am, make laws.
Ma'am, make the law.
What does the executive
yes, ma'am.
Do? Executive.
Ma'am, execute
and the law. Implements the law.
All right, it implements the law. And what does the judiciary do? It sees that the laws are followed, and if the laws are broken, so it punishes the lawbreakers also. Okay.
Yes, ma'am.
So we have three organs: the legislature, executive, and judiciary. Now, this sharing of power among the different organs of the government is called as horizontal distribution of power. All right. Horizontal, you know, this is horizontal and this is vertical, right? So this is called as the horizontal distribution of power, because all these different levels of all these different organs of the government are placed at the same level. All right, so it is not that one has more power and the other is less. No, all of them are at the same level, and hence it is called as the horizontal distribution of power. Now, why the power is separated? So that no organ can have unlimited power. All right, and distribution is made in such a manner, the rules and regulations are made in such a manner so that no organ of the government can have unlimited power, and each organ, it checks the other. So basically what it leads to, it leads to a balance of power among the various institutions. Now we know that our executive is made answerable to the legislature. You know, executive is the ruling government. It is a very strong body. So, you know, once in power, they can do whatever they wish. And that is why, you know, they are made answerable to the legislature. And though, you know, like judiciary also, members of the people, the judges of the High Court and Supreme Court, you know, though they are nominated by the executive, but though once in power, you know, they can even give orders on the executive or on the legislative body. And so, you know, the distribution, this all is done in such a manner so that there is a balance of power and there is a check on their power also, so that no one can misuse their power. And now last year we have studied that in a democracy we have ministers and government officials, though they are there, but you know, they are responsible to the parliament or the state assembly. So like I told you, though, you know, the ruling government, though they have so much power, but still they are answerable to the legislative body. And similarly, the judges, though they are appointed by the executive, but they can check the functioning of the executive or even the laws which are made by the legislature. And you know that even the laws which are passed by the legislature, which are not according to the constitution, the judiciary can call those laws null, void, means of no effect at all. So that is how the powers are kept in check, so that no one can misuse their power. This is one of the arrangements of power sharing that we know of. The second one is that power can also be shared among different levels of the government. All right. In our country, how many levels of government do we have? Yes, in our country, at how many levels do we have a government?
Ma'am, two levels.
All right,
ma'am, central, state, and ma'am, local.
I'm central.
Okay, so central, state, and local governing bodies, local state
local.
Bodies. All right. Okay, now.
Yes, ma'am.
Now we have a general government or the central government, normally, you know, which is for the entire country. And now having a government at more than level, what type of government it is called? Yes, if you have government at more than one level, what type of government is it called?
No, federal.
Right, federal form of government.
Federal, yes.
Yes, so we have a federal form of government. We have government at more than one level. So, you know, earlier when we started with two levels, but later on a third tier or a third level was also incorporated or added. Now, in India, we call the general government as the central or the union government, and the government at the provincial level or the regional level, and you know, they are called that with different names at different places, but in India, we call them the state government. Then, you know, but this system is not followed in all countries. Now, there are many countries where there are no states or no provincial governments. And, you know, but in those countries where there are different levels of government, you know, there the constitution, it clearly tells what would be the powers of the different levels of government. So, you know, some have also a unitary form of government. We have a federal form of government. We have government at more than one level. Unitary form of government, they have government only at one level. So they don't have provincial or state level governments, but countries like us, like those who have a federal form of government, you know, there in their constitution, specifically, it is told that what would be the powers of each level of government. And then, you know, this is what they're saying, that this is what they did in Belgium, but was refused in Sri Lanka. So we have seen when we were doing the chapters that, you know, they decided in Belgium that they will share power. So they had a central government also, and they have state governments also. And, you know, they have given so much power to the state governments that the state governments were not subordinate to the central government in Belgium. But this they refused to do with people in Sri Lanka. And you know, the Tamilians, they were asking for autonomy, more freedom in the regions where they were more in population. But you know, their demands were not met. And now this federal, this is called as the, you know, federal division of power. And you know, the same principle, it can be extended to the levels of government even lower than the state government. And now this also we have in our country in the form of local self-governing bodies, in the form of panchayats and villages. In towns we have you know, municipalities, and in cities like Lucknow we have municipal cooperation. Now we call this division of power involving the higher and the lower levels of government, we call it as the vertical division of power. So, division of power among the organs, different organs of the government, is a horizontal division of power. But division of power among the different levels of the government, it is called as the vertical division of power. And we will study about this more in the next chapter when we will do federalism in detail. So, then we will study more about this form of power sharing. Now, the third is that power, it can also be shared among the different social groups, you know, just like the religious groups or linguistic groups, just like the community government in Belgium. So, that is a good example of this kind of arrangement. Then, you know, in some countries, there are also some arrangements in the constitution or some arrangements in laws whereby what happens, the weaker sections of a society or women, you know, they are also represented in legislatures and administration. You know, in our country also, we have seats reserved for the scheduled castes, the scheduled tribes. Yes or no? You know that we have reserved constituencies?
Yes, ma'am.
And you know, for the local self-governing bodies in the third level, we also have some seats reserved. How many seats are reserved for the women in the third level of a government? Any idea?
Ma'am, 30%.
One-third seats. Yes, one-third seats. So it is around 33.33%. So one-third seats are reserved for women in the third level of a government here. And now, last year when we studied the system of reserved constituencies in assemblies and in the parliament of a country, we have done that. Now this type of arrangement basically is required to give some you know, to those social groups you know, who had been discriminated and who had not been treated equally for a long time. and you know, so we give them this special treatment so that they may not feel separated or alienated from the government. And this method is used to give the minority communities a fair share in government. And then now later on we will look at this also. We come to the fourth type of power sharing, and now the power sharing arrangements can also be seen in which the political parties or the pressure groups or the movements, they control or influence the power. Now you know, in a democracy, we the citizens, we have the freedom that we can choose anyone whom we wish to rule over us. And so you know, there are so many people, so many contenders now in our country. You know, we have so many national parties, so many state parties, and there are many independent candidates also standing for elections. And so you know, there are various contenders for power. And now in modern democracies, in democracies in today's time, now this basically takes the form of having competition among the different political parties. So like, you know, in our country also, whenever we have elections, it is basically like there's a competition among the different political parties. And so you know, what this type of competition, it makes sure that the power, it does not remain in one hand for a long time. And so basically what happens in the long run is, we if we see that power is shared among different political parties, and you know, now these different political parties, they have their own ideologies, and you know, they support different social groups also. And so you know, when the different social these political parties, they are coming to power, so basically what we mean to say is that different, we are shared, the power is shared among so many different types of people. You know, those who have different ideologies, those who support different groups. And sometimes now this sharing of power can also be direct. You know, sometimes what happens before elections, two or more parties, they come together and they form an alliance, and then together as an alliance they contest the elections. All right, and you know, then if the alliance is elected, they form a coalition government. And sometimes, you know, even after elections also, if one party is not able to form government on its own, so two or three parties, they come together, two or more parties, they come together to form a coalition government. And so you know, in this way there is a direct sharing of power among the different political parties in one government only. And then you know, in addition to these sharing of power among the different political parties in a democracy, we also have different interest groups. Like you know, we have groups for traders and businessmen and teachers and industrialists and farmers and workers. And you know, we have trade unions and labor's unions and all. And you know, they also have a share in the government power. And you know, either they do it through participation in the government communities, or they try to influence or bring pressure on the decision making process. And this could be done through strikes and demonstrations, and many times, you know, like through protests also, and through movements also. And now later on in this book, we will, in this during the course of this tour of democracy, we will also have a look at the working of the political parties, pressure groups and social movements in detail. But as of today, we will stop here. So this is how power is shared among different organs or different levels of the government, the various social groups also, and among the political parties and the interest groups and pressure groups in a contemporary or a modern democracy. And so what we can say is that really we have seen that why power sharing is so desirable. We have already seen that it removes the possibility of conflict, it leads to the stability of the government, and it looks and it maintains the unity of the country. And then morally also, it is the spirit of democracy, because those who are to be governed, now those who are to be affected by the laws, now they also need to be consulted as to how they want to be governed. And so or in a democracy, we try that as many people as possible should have a share in the decision making process. Okay, so have you all understood what we have done today? Yes, class?
Yes, ma'am.
Is it clear yes, to all ma'am. Of you?
Yes, ma'am.
All right, so
ma'am?
When we meet tomorrow,
ma'am, can
then
you explain,
yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, can you explain the bathroom?
What?
Ma'am, can you re-explain the last point, ma'am, power sharing?
Beta, now tomorrow
forms of power
have,
sharing.
Tomorrow I will explain it again because we have already crossed the time limit. Okay?
Yes,
so
ma'am.
Tomorrow we have a class, then I will again explain the fourth point and then we will also continue with the questions. Alright, so that would be all for today.